Click on the link online or place your donation in the offering plate noting playground. Advent readers needed for December 8th, both services, December 15th, 11 a.m., December 22nd, both services, and December 24th, 11. Please, 11 p.m. Please contact Nicole and the church in the office if you can help. Church directory. Tuesday appointments have been filled. There are only two Wednesday appointments left, but there are many Monday slots available. On Monday, December 9th, from 12 to 6:30 p.m., we still have a lot more slots to be filled, and Miss Emmy is in the back if you still want to sign up, and she'll be helping you sign up. Wednesday, December 11th, at 3:48 or 5:48 p.m., there are still more slots to be filled. And if you do not want your information to be online, we'll make sure that it does not go anywhere it's not supposed to go. Do we have any other announcements?
Yeah.
Mr. Mike.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So, speaking with pastor and a leader of our care ministries. We need to get the actual text out. Talk about this. There is a young family in our church family who is in need of some dire financial support. They're going through some times right now. If you feel so inclined to donate to them, there are these white envelopes. You can put it in here and just write needy family on there, drop it in the plate, and it will get to them, I promise. Made the same announcement earlier, and they donated well, and hopefully we can donate well to help support our family in their need. So thank you very much. Yep. Amen.
Online
also, yes. You can donate online. And like I said, just make a note, say, needy family. Put it in the envelope, do it online. Come by the church office Monday, Tuesday. Donate if you want to do it that way. However, we can make it easy on you to help donate to the family so we can help lift them up. Thank you.
Do we have any other announcements? Any first-time visitors? Okay.
Well, Susan, do we have our appointment yet for our family photograph?
Good, because I didn't want to miss it. I want to get another photograph done before I started looking old.
Sorry.
Who said that?
That was a long time ago.
Okay, it's so good to have you all this morning. We got another photograph. We had just about standing room only in the first service, so we need to get our photos out of the photograph. Give them back time here for our church service. Okay. How about Come You Thankful People Come, our traditional Thanksgiving song. It's on page 694. The bulletin says 69, but it's actually 694. Or projected, so let us all stand.
Thank you.
Church family.
Good morning.
Jake.
There we are. Time for prayers and praises and thanksgiving. Y'all ready for some thanksgiving? All right, we're going to give thanks in here today for sure. We're thankful for Anna Simmons being back with us. She praises God. Thank you for your prayers. As well as Wanda Kyle, who's just beaming with God's spirit. Also happy to be back in the house of God. We need to pray for Jim Lundy by Carolyn Graham. He's in the hospital, needs some prayers, as well as Andy, his daughter Lindley. They're both their praise team people. He's the drummer, she sings, his daughter, they're in the hospital. She's supposed to be released today, perhaps. We shall see. Anything else? You got it. Yes, ma'am.
Thanksgiving. 2 months son and I went to Tennessee to help a friend whose husband's very ill, and we need a safety there and back despite multiple accidents on the road. We thank God.
Thank God. Safe travel.
Pray for my friend's husband Nathan. He has trouble with every breath and oxygen. We're hoping he gets to come home.
Yeah, prayers for Nathan.
And you remember the Odell family, Brandy and her two of her children were in a car accident on Tuesday. And unfortunately, she and her 1-year-old were killed. So she left 4 children and 3
children raising her daughter. Odell family. Had a bad car accident. The mother, the child were killed. There's a lot of pain and suffering there. So let's remember the Odell family. Yes, ma'am, one.
I am so glad to be back here today. You don't know. I'm just so I'm just so thankful to be here. And let me tell you, I felt every prayer that was going up for me. And I just appreciate all the calls, the texts, the cards, everything. It was a time-consuming way that I don't even like to think about it because I was so sick and done. But anyway, I'm just glad to be back in the house of the Lord and to be with my church family that I just love to pieces. And again, just thank you all. And just, I'm just, again, glad to be here. Thank you.
Yes, sir. John. Kathy's health and healing. Kathy Robertson needs some prayers. Anyone else? Yes, sir. Mikey.
Hopefully, my newest project
will be
at school.
What? I'm sorry. Something at school? You got a project at school? Oh, a comic book, and you're hoping that it goes well and it's accepted well, you get an A+.
It's not
just for fun. Okay. Hey, if you get bored in class, you can always make a comic book.
Praise and a prayer.
Okay, praise and a prayer.
The Christie family have been blessed with a grandson.
Yay!
Hudson. He is in the NICU, and he's going to be a fighter. And we just ask for prayers for the whole family.
All right. We got a new baby boy, but we need to pray for continued grace for healing.
Yep.
Good. Yes, sir.
Pray for my daughter, Rachel. She's still dealing with drug addiction.
Okay. We pray for Rachel.
Treatment now.
Good.
She's been battling that for a while.
Praise God. We get into it. Yes.
I got word from Chandler Kane. He's one of the youth that was a member here. He just finished boot camp about a week or two ago.
Chandler Kane just finished boot camp. Praise God. Anyone else?
This sounds bad from his mother. Noah sees a cardiovascular specialist tomorrow. For those that don't know, he was in the hospital with heart problems and pain too. His primary care was worried that his connective tissue disorder is affecting his heart.
Prayers to the Lord. Y'all about ready to pray?
Got
you got one?
Got a praise.
A praise, yes, please.
Let Thursday afternoon and evening at my daughter's house, April's house.
April's house.
About 10 of her friends. She did Friendsgiving.
Friendsgiving.
And there was at least 10 kids under 5 running all over the place.
God bless you.
And it was wonderful.
Well, glad it was wonderful.
Good.
Yeah, I didn't have to keep that.
Prayers for my mom, Ellen, for comfort and
peace. Okay. Pray for Ellen.
My family went to West Virginia. They're going to visit their daughter at WVU, and they're going to bring my granddaughter back. So I'm having dinner with his fine couple right here. So they're
good.
So I don't know if
you'll
be in church Sunday or might have to call you to
get us out of jail. All right. I don't have good luck with that, but you can call. Kind of once you're in there, it's just a thing, you know. Did I see you?
Yes. Gary and I have a friend who tailgate with me, Hal. He's going through prostate cancer.
Hal.
Hal.
With prostate cancer. Needs prayer. All right, we're going to pray, but before we do that, I got something fun I want to do. Y'all like having fun in church, don't you? Well, I got some good news, something we can all be thankful for. We got two great people wanting to join our church, Dick and Maya Westrum. Would y'all mind just kind of standing, if you can, Maya? I don't know, working too hard. Yeah. Just so y'all can see them real good. Can y'all see them? There you go. Now, Dick and Meyer are living at Penny Farms, but they've been to Canada, to the Middle East, to Nebraska, doing ministry for over 50-something years. Maya's been in education, but certainly in ministry with Dick. And we're just blessed and thankful to have y'all with us. Now, here's the question. Will you be faithful, loyal to this global Methodist church called Black Creek, and support it with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, and your service, and your witness?
Yes, we will.
Now, church, will you do the same for them? Support them with your prayers, your presence, fellowship, and all that good stuff?
Yes.
All right, we're in it together. God bless you. Give them a hand. Dick's a fine preacher, too. He's going to fill in for me a few times here in the future. He knows that. He don't know the date yet, but I got one coming. Anything else? That was fun. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Almighty, ever-loving, everlasting God, we come with thankful hearts. We, your children, the people of your flock, the lambs of your own choosing, and we are thankful to be in your house today. Thankful to be with one another, to lift each other up, to lift up these prayer concerns to you, O God, trusting in your all-sufficient grace, trusting in your powerful touch, that we pray for right now, all these that were named, all that are on our hearts and minds, unspoken, and we just want to see you at work in our lives and feel you, Lord, and just to know that you are there, right in the midst of all our troubles and tribulations and trials, and even in the celebrations and the joys and all the fun, you're there in the midst of us. So thank you, Holy Spirit, for connecting us to God the Father, to Jesus the Son, our Lord, who died on the cross that we might have a relationship with God the Father and be filled with the Holy Spirit, to be a powerful presence on earth, to be Jesus for others. Be our vision, Lord. Help us to grow as your church, spiritually, numerically, and to be the kind of people you've created us to be. Now, there are lots of other things, Lord, that we're dealing with and struggling with, and it's good to just be here in your house, to be away from all the stuff, away from that TV for a minute, and to just be in your presence, to worship you, to praise you, and to pour out our hearts so that you might heal us and give us peace. So I thank you for everyone in this room. I thank you for those who can't be here. I thank you for those in the hospital, that you're with them and you're working, using doctors and nurses and supporting staff and all the medicines and stuff, Lord, that can bring healing. And above all that, we just pray that you're there and you touch them. You are the great physician, the great I am. There are none greater than you. And we trust you that you're you're at work. Sometimes we see it, sometimes we do not see it, but we know you're at work. So thank you, Lord, for this season of Thanksgiving. I pray for all those who are traveling. Keep them safe, oh Lord. And we're going to give you praise. We're going to give you glory as we sit around our tables, fellowshipping with family and loved ones and those who maybe are isolated and alone. May they find somebody or somebody find them and welcome them in, Lord. So thank you. Thank you for this place we call our church home. We pray for all her ministries to bring you praise and glory and more people for salvation and more disciples. Make us your disciples, we pray in Jesus' name. The one who loved us first and will love us throughout eternity. And we pray, just as he taught the first disciples to pray, by saying, Our Father. You have your Bibles with you this morning. We're going to look at Matthew chapter 6 and read and study verses 25 through 34. I think it's a text that you've heard before, but perhaps God will shed some new light on it and bring it back into your mind and heart that it might do something in your life positively and help us. Because therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink or about your body. What you will wear, is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Take a look at the birds of the air. Neither do they sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not more value than they? And can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your span of life? And why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin, yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Therefore do not worry, saying, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? For there's the Gentiles who strive for all these things. And indeed, your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But strive first for the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And all these things will be given to you as well. So do not worry about tomorrow. For tomorrow will bring enough worries of its own. Today's trouble is enough for today. The word of God for the people of God. Praise be to God. Amen. Take a trip back a little bit. The dark days of 1929. A group of ministers met in the Northeast, all graduates of Boston School of Theology. They gathered to discuss how they would conduct their Thanksgiving Sunday services. Things were about as bad as they could get with no sign of relief. The bread lines were depressingly long, the stock market plummeted, and the term Great Depression seemed an apt description for the mood of the country. The ministers thought they should only lightly touch upon the subject of Thanksgiving in deference, to the human misery all around them. After all, what was there to be thankful for? But it was Dr. William Stigger, pastor of a large congregation in the city that rallied the group. This was not the time, he suggested,
to give a mere passing mention to Thanksgiving, just the opposite. This was time for the nation to get matters in perspective and thank God for blessings always present, but perhaps suppressed due to hardship and intense hardship. I like what they're touching on. These ministers are getting to something. The most intense moments of thankfulness are not really found in times of plenty, are they? But when difficulties abound. Think of the pilgrims. That first Thanksgiving. Half of their number were dead. Men without a country. But still there was a thanksgiving to their God. Their gratitude was not for something, but in something, you see? It was the same sense of gratitude that led Abraham Lincoln to formally establish the first Thanksgiving Day in the midst of national civil war, when the butcher's list of casualties seemed to have no end and the very nation struggled for survival. Perhaps in your own life, right now, there's intense hardship. You're experiencing your own personal Great Depression. Why should I be thankful this day? May I suggest a few things? First, we must be thankful as God's people. Because if you're not thankful, you'll become bitter. Even the mention of the word conjures up a particular look upon the face of a bitter person. The person who's constantly unsatisfied with their life. Nothing makes them happy. And they purposefully make life miserable, not only for themselves, but also for those who have the misfortune of being around them. The bitter person becomes absorbed with the question, why me? He feels that he's been shortchanged. Dr. Jim Moore, Christian author and pastor of a 12,000-member church of St. Luke's United Methodist in Houston, Texas. Several years ago, he wrote a little book that perhaps you've seen or you have. It's entitled, You Can Get Bitter or You Can Get Better. He told the story of a 26-year-old woman in his congregation whose husband died in a bizarre accident. While driving his tractor, he touched an electrical line that killed him instantly. Now, here she was, three children, insufficient money, and hopes dashed. She says, I don't know what I'm going to do without him, but I do know my choices. I can get bitter, or I can get better. I'm turning to the church so I can get better. Isn't that good? I think that's part of why we come here. She underscored a universal truth. When trouble slams us, we do have choices, don't we? Ralph Sockman, a renowned Methodist minister of a generation ago, used to express it this way. He said, a grief is a sorrow we carry in our hearts. A grievance is a chip we wear on our shoulder. All of us must face trouble. None are immune. I stand before you this moment as one whose suit or clerical robe provides no shelter from misfortune. I'm in it with y'all. At one time or another, trouble will come to all of us, place its hand on our shoulder, speak our name, and say to us, come, walk with me a little while. And we do. Why is it that 9 of the 10 lepers never returned to give thanks to Jesus, if you recall that story? We're not told, but I suspect that they had become so embittered that they had all the thankfulness squeezed out of them. There's only one anecdote for the embittered mind. What is it? A thankful heart. I think that's better than becoming a sour disciple, isn't it? Don't become self-absorbed with the issue of why me? For a season, it might offer you a little comfort, but it does no good in the end, does it? Do we ever ask that question when some joy comes into our life? Oh God, why me? We don't. We take it, we celebrate it, we share it with others. I think also, though, we must learn to be thankful or we'll become discouraged. Become bitter, discouraged. I think it's an inescapable tenet of Christianity that hardship will come. No one is immune, the greatest to the least of us. I think the Bible's an encouraging book. What do you think? I think it's good to read it. We should read it often. Study it. Memorize it. Remember, Jesus said, don't let your hearts be troubled. Another time he said, fear not, for lo, I am with you always. And Paul encouraged the church at Philippi, rejoice in the Lord always. So you reflect on the events of your life this Thanksgiving. I challenge you to ask yourself this question. If it had not been for God, where would I be? Focus on that the next few days leading up to Thanksgiving. Where would you be right now if it were not for God? Where would you be? Would you be isolated, mentally broken, financially ruined, physically destroyed? But here's the good news. God has not let you down, so be of good cheer. As you sit down with family, look around. Don't waste the opportunity. Ask yourself, where would I be without her? Where would I be without him? It's not the test of character when everything you touch turns to gold. The true test comes when we've been knocked down. The Apostle Paul wrote, in everything give thanks. It's not the test of faith to give thanks when the sun is shining. It's not the test of character when everything you touch turns to gold. The true test comes as we get up again and up again and up again. Amen? I mean, we've got to learn to give thanks to God. I mean, we're going to spend eternity in His presence. And over and over and over and over and over again in Scripture, it says God delights in a thankful heart, a grateful heart. So you got to learn to be thankful, church, or else you'll surely grow arrogant and self-satisfied. And I believe mankind believes everything we achieve has been of our own making. But the truth teaches us that none are independent. Anybody remember the Jimmy Stewart movie Shenandoah? The time frame is the Civil War. He's the father of a very large family. Each mealtime they gather around the table, he gives the exact same blessing. Oh Lord, we planted the seed, then harvested the crop. If we had not put the food on the table, it wouldn't be sitting there. But Lord, we give you thanks anyway. That's the problem with a thankless heart. We end up giving credit where credit's not due. There are many things that confound me in life. But the one anchor my soul has always been gratitude. You ever come over to the parsonage? We got those little Etsy signs all over the place. Be grateful, be thankful. Thankful, grateful, blessed. That stuff's all over the place. Not that I need reminding, but because it's true. Martin Rinker, the minister of a little town in Eilenburg, Germany, some 350 years ago. He was the son of a poor coppersmith, but somehow he managed to work his way through an education. Finally, in the year 1617, he was offered the post of archdeacon in his hometown parish. A year later, what has come to be known as the 30 Years' War broke out. His town caught right in the middle. In 1637, a massive plague swept through the continent of Eilenburg, and people died at the rate of 50 a day. And The man called upon to bury most of them was Martin. In all, over 8,000 people died, including Martin's own wife. His labors finally came to an end about 11 years later, just 1 year after the conclusion of the war. His ministry spanned 32 years, all but the first and the last, overwhelmed by the great conflict that engulfed his town. Tough circumstances in which to be thankful, amen. But he managed, and he wrote some beautiful words, and they're on page 102 in your hymnal. I'm just going to read them. He wrote, "Now thank we all our God with heart and hands and voices, who wondrous things hath done, in whom this world rejoices." I pray that in times of sorrow and distress, you too can find those kind of words to describe who and what God is doing in your life. I mean, it takes a magnificent spirit to come through such hardship and express gratitude. But I think here today is a great lesson, church. Surrounded by tremendous adversity, I believe thanksgiving delivers us. And it will deliver you with heart and hand and voice. Amen? Amen. Praise team, let's worship our way out of here. Let's pray while they make themselves ready. Lord Jesus, thank you that we don't have to worry about anything today. What we eat, how we're dressed, anything. You've got it all covered. In the end, we're all going to be okay. So help us as our hearts are hurting. Family, people we love will be missing this Thanksgiving. Heal us, comfort us, and be our guide through it all. And we're going to give you thanks and praise, whatever we experience in this life, knowing that thankfulness and a heart of gratitude delivers us from all evil. Thank you for that truth, Lord. And we give you praise in Jesus' name.
Please stand as we close today's service. With amazing grace, my chains are gone and forever.
Secure, He will my shield and more.
our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the sweet communion of His Holy Spirit be with you all and make us grateful people. Amen.
Ball going in.